And I just opened it up, and all I saw was this desperate geezer going, fucking, I'll forge the signature, fuck you. I'm like, what is going on?
Pro boxing fans here in London, it's Fight Week AD and it's your birthday. Happy birthday. How's it going? 44 years, 45 years old? How old?
Oh, 44, steady. I'll be honest with you, I'm feeling unbelievable. I mean, I feel better than I did in my 20s. Obviously looking unbelievable as well. But no, feeling good, excited. I mean, we've got obviously this show on Saturday, then we've got a 6-week run around the world. And so I live and breathe this job. I live and breathe these shows. I love it. So can't wait.
Let's quickly get this done. Obviously, not got much time. Sonny Edwards talked about it over there. He said, listen, I want the big fights. They're not getting made. They might not even get made after this fight. But what's the path for Sonny Edwards after this fight?
Yeah, well, what I'll do is I'll make your job easier for you. We'll start off with Before the Bell. Got three great prospects in George Liddard, Shannon Ryan and Muhammad Ali. We've got a great 50-50 matchup between Yusuf Kamari and Rhys Bellotti. That's on Before the Bell. Then we go into the main card. Three world championship fights. First up, Nina Hughes. Great win over Jamie Mitchell against Birmingham's Katie Healy. Then we've got Chev Clark against David Jameson. This is a great fight. Final eliminator for the British Cruiserweight title. I think it's a fantastic fight. We've got Johnny Fisher and his Mad Army coming over as well. Looking forward to plenty of noise there. Then we've got Ellie Scotney against Shanika Johnson. Fantastic fight for the world title as well. And then let's talk about Sonny Showtime Edwards, because this guy is starting to fascinate me. I never really used to like him. I don't mind saying it. I got to know him. I got to realise how intelligent he is. But I also got to realise how good he is. When I see him beat Mufalani, I thought, I'm not sure anyone can beat him. And the confidence he has, the abilities, I think he can be a British great. But this is quite a big pressure fight, because he talks about Campos isn't on my level and this. So really, you should be steaming through this guy. You know, and I think that's the pressure of Saturday night. I think this kid could be a superstar. And he will fight anyone. So let's see what he does on Saturday.
Cool. I do want to talk about other things in boxing. Obviously, every time I talk to you, there seems to be other people talking about you. Yesterday, Frank Warren's done an interview, said that the comments that you made that the Fury offer is a PR stunt is absolute crap. And yeah, go on, respond like that.
I never said that the Fury offer was necessarily a PR stunt. But listen, someone tagged me in that Frank Warren interview yesterday, and I just opened it up, and all I saw was this desperate geezer going, fucking, I'll forge the signature, fuck you. I'm like, what is going on? But like, I think George Warren would have watched that interview yesterday and gone, Dad, what are you doing? And like, to just so you don't think I'm being a hater, I do the same thing when my old man does an interview. When he comes to a show and you boys want to grab a word with Barry Hearn, I'm like this, you know, don't, mate, he's got a couple of minutes, he's all right. And then, you know, don't do it, because these guys, like, they're still sharp and they're smart, but they're done in boxing. The future is sensible conversations like I can have with George. We don't always get a deal done, but we don't sit there shouting and screaming at each other. You know, it's like, you look so desperate. And actually, I've got this guy going, there's the deal, 60-40. I'm looking at him as so desperate. I'm thinking it should be 60-40 to Joshua. So you ain't really doing a great job. And you've got nowhere to go, they're saying. They're not going to Saudi because they haven't had an offer. Joshua's fighting in August and December. So what's Tyson Fury going to do? He's up shit creek without a paddle. And they're just showing desperation. But I didn't like it because, for years, everyone's talked about, can't Matcham and Queensbury work together? And Frank's never allowed it, really. And maybe I've been at fault as well over time. Now, with George, who's come in with a clear head, without ego, without history, we can get things done. But when that happens, AJ watches that, I watch it, and you just think, like, you move so far backwards in everything. It's just, they should know better, really. But I understand they, you know, and I think the public have wised up. You've got to look at the comments on these videos, yeah? It's like, it's completely changed. It used to be like, Hearn and Joshua, they're ducking. Now it's like, Paul, the other one, we're sick and tired of this, of hearing this rubbish. So, I don't know. I thought it was madness, but listen, it's not my business.
Obviously, with the whole situation, Tyson Fury is still looking for an opponent. Do you feel like he's prizing himself out of fights? I know you've said it.
Listen, if you are telling people how much you want for a fight, and people and the market aren't prepared to pay it, you are pricing yourself out of fights. It's all very well saying, well, that's my value in the fight, but it's not, is it? Because it's like putting a house on for sale, saying, my house is worth 20 million, but people only want to pay 10. You can't say, well, that's what my house is worth, and I'm not budging. Guess what? You ain't going to sell it, and no one's interested in it, that money. So what Tyson Fury did is he went to Saudi, he said, I want, whatever it was, 120 million to fight Usyk. And everyone went, pfft. And then later on, he came back and went, oh, actually, I'll do it. You know, if you want to make fights, you find a way to make fights, right? And right now, it don't look like he's fighting Usyk. I don't even think he wants to fight Usyk, but like, whatever. I think he would do, and that's why he gave the number, because he'll fight him for that number. But if I'm looking at Tyson Fury's career now, he boxed in December. You know, Frank Warren's talking about, oh, Dillian White, well, they're going to the cemetery to dig up an opponent. I love Del Boy. He just boxed Del Boy in December. He hasn't boxed since, right? It's now coming up. We're in June. Now it'll be July. He can't fight until September because you've got to build a fight. Who's it going to be? He wants so much money for a fight. You can't afford an opponent that is of any interest to anybody. So he either has to sit out and make a deal with the Saudis for the December fight, or fight someone rubbish in September, which will mean he'll miss out on the December fight. He's in absolute no man's land right now. And listen, if we don't get a deal done with the Saudis, we'll revisit the fight in September. But after interviews like that, it just doesn't make, like, you've got to understand how people work. Like, AJ opens that and goes, what? You know? Rather than when me and George had a conversation, the conversation was, let's not talk too much in interviews, on social media. Let's not be disrespectful. Let's be calm. And everybody did it. And then Frank comes in, little headbutting the microphone and everything. Not smart.
Oscar De La Hoya, another person that's come out online.
Yeah, I mean, look, it's very different when you talk about Frank Warren to Oscar De La Hoya, because Frank Warren is angry and emotional sometimes, but Oscar De La Hoya is an idiot sometimes. He wants to slag me off continuously, non-stop, right? And talk about, this guy don't know what he's doing, he don't know how to promote, he's an idiot for putting Canelo in with Bivol. And then I get asked a question about Ryan Garcia, where I say, I cannot believe he's calling him out on social media and didn't turn up to the presser. And then he wants to tweet me saying, stay in your lane, this is your last warning. You can't take the heat, mate. You can't take any criticism. I'm like Batfink. You won't remember Batfink. You know, my wings are a shield of steel. All these bullets are coming out. I'm ping, 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 ping. They're like this. One bad comment, one bit of criticism. Oh, the toys are out of the pram. I'm a pound for pound great. I don't give a fuck. I got asked a question. You slagged me off non-stop. I gave my opinion. And now you're warning me and I've got to stay in my lane. Do me a favour.
Final one from myself. A recent signing, Regis Progray. Seems to be in the headlines quite a lot. Yeah. Devin Haney's talking about him. Adrian Broner, who's fighting tomorrow, is talking about, look, if I win, I want that Progray fight. I respect him. I want that fight. Jack Cattrall is another one. Good fighter too, I've signed. What's the path for him then?
Jack Cattrall's our priority. You know, he's a Matchroom fighter. I love him. Sam Jones is on me every day. We want the Regis Progray fight. That's our number one priority. Of course, making Haney against Progray is big for our US business as well. I've not heard about the Broner stuff. Listen, if he looks good, it's a big fight. But I'm excited about Regis. I think he's the best fighter at 140 pounds right now. We'll see him perform next week in New Orleans, and then he's going to be a big fight in the winter.
Eddie, thank you very much for talking to Pro Box Fans. Thank you.